Now, I would like to introduce our guest speaker who shall unlock the doors to the leader in you. Mr. Praful Talera, Managing Director, Dynamic Logistics. Sir, may I have your permission to please begin? Thank you, sir. Sir is presently the member of Western Region Family Business Subcommittee, Confederation of Indian Industry. Sir also holds the position of Managing Director at Dynamic Logistics. People speak about him as an intellectual and commercial gravitas of the logistic industry in India. He is also said to be a natural lover, a nature leader, a charming and enthusiastic host. Sir is also the member of Latin America and Caribbean Committee, Confederation of Indian Industry. With this, I request sir to kindly address the batch.
Nice to see you all. Welcome to Pune. I think most of you are from outside Pune. Yeah? And I hope Pune will treat you very well in the 2 years you will be here. Yeah? I've been born and brought up in Pune. I love this city. Please take out time and explore this place whilst you are here. It's a beautiful place, a lot of greenery, a lot of forts, and lovely weather. The topic, can you hear me all?
Yes, yeah? Sir.
The topic is the master keys that control world trade. Now I can promise you one thing definitely, at the end of my presentation, you will never look at the world map in the same way again. That I assure you. Right? How does this work? Sorry. It's not on now, sorry. Just take 2 minutes to read this, please. most of us tend to make rocket science out of everything. Things are very simple actually, if you go deeper into it, it's very, very simple. But now, out of our own pompousness, our own self-importance and our own idea of our own selves, we try to make simple things very difficult at times. See, this is a very, very simple way of looking at the world, and that's what I'm going to share with you. You remember this always, that 70% of the world, as we all know, is water, the oceans, the seas, the rivers. 80% of the population of the world lives within 200 nautical miles of the sea, right? 80% of the world's population. And 90% of world trade goes by sea. The most expensive, the most cheapest form of transport is water. Then comes rail, then comes road, and then air. Air is the most expensive form of transport. Since I think logistics is one of your subjects, you should know this. It's always water, rail, road, and air. Right? See, this is our ancient Nadi Shastra. If you go to a Ved, he will check your health by seeing your pulse, right? And this is a concept which, see, this is the chakra theory in our ancient philosophies. Actually, they correspond with your endocrine glands, your hormonal system. You know, your spine is your prime meridian. The prime meridian in our body is the spine. I am using this concept. In all ancient healing and Ayurveda, they use any massages. Now, there are certain points on the human body which, if they are stimulated, can heal you. But those same points, if they are damaged, they can cripple you as well. You know, they use these same points in the martial arts. If anyone knows about Kalaripayattu, the Kalaripayattu is the old ancient martial art out of Kerala. And the word karate comes from Kalaripayattu. The word karate comes from Kalaripayattu. So these same points can be used to cripple someone and heal someone as well. The yin and yang. So this is the prime meridian. No? Which is, where is the prime meridian? Any guesses? The prime meridian is the 0 degree longitude on which we base our time. Now GMT, no? The Greenwich Mean Time, is the prime meridian. That is 0 degrees longitude. This is a purely arbitrary line. There is nothing, God hasn't drawn this line. This line has been drawn by the British. See, in our ancient, if you go to a Pandit, kya meri janam patri bana dijiye, so he'll ask you, aapka janam kahan hua tha? What time kya hai? Because as per the Indian calendar, our prime meridian is in Ujjain, as per the Hindu calendar. The prime meridian is in Ujjain. So at different points of time in history, the prime meridians have been different. See, when the Roman Empire was there, the prime meridian was through Rome. So when the British did it, they did it to London. Greenwich is like, you know, if you've been anyone from Pune, yeah? No one from Pune? Yeah, see, there is a suburb of Pune called Shivaji Nagar, where the Met office is there, the meteorological office. So Greenwich is the meteorological office of London, right? So the out of this GMT and the longitude came the lat-long grid. This grid was born out of the, see, you need to have zero somewhere. Anyone from Nagpur here? See, Nagpur is the zero milestone of India, right? See, when the British surveyed India, you have to have zero somewhere. So where? They put the zero in Nagpur. And all distances in India have been measured from that zero milestone. If you go to Pune, the general post office here, there is a stone outside there. It's called the zero milestone of Pune. So all distances are measured from that zero milestone. So this became the zero milestone for the world, Greenwich. And that's how the lat-long grid came about. And all your GPS systems work on this grid. See, when they map your route or whatever is on this lat-long grid. This is a dog with a choke chain. It's similar to a tie. You know, when I wear a tie, I know I'm on duty. Right? These guys know they are to pay attention, sit straight and listen to the speaker, right? So, it just smartens you up. But what is a dog with a choke chain? See, all police dogs, all dogs which are trained, the technique used is this chain. Ye fasi ka fanda hai. Right? You ladies better know this. You know, you have to handle men. This is the way you need to handle them. See, this chain is choked and he's trained. So, first command is heel. For a dog train, you should have a dog training session for them, sir. Very instructive, very similar to human beings. Dogs and human beings are very similar. You know, the first command is heel, so he'll come and sit here, right? And the last command is about 20 commands or something, is attack. A police dog can attack on command and he'll go for your right hand because that's generally the weapon hand. Now, if someone is having a knife or a gun or something, so the dog will just go and catch a hand. It's really very interesting to see a police dog being trained. So, and it is only trained with this chain. If he doesn't listen, usko ek thoda jhatka dete hai, so he feels throttled. So he listens. And the reward is a small piece of biscuit. If he listens, biscuit milega, nahi sunega to jhatka milega. That's how a dog is trained. And this logic, this is how a choke chain is. Simple. It's like a fasi ka fanda. Right? So when the British mapped the world, they realized that there are certain points on the world map which are like, see, geography is a constant. Sorry, I want to tell you this. There are two things according to me which are a constant. Right? We always say what is constant? Change is the only constant in life. Right? But geography is also a relative constant. Geography doesn't change. What doesn't change in our lives generally? Can you move the Himalayas? They are growing at a very minuscule rate of 0.0 whatever. They are the youngest mountains in the world. But see, by and large, geography doesn't change. And which is the other thing doesn't change? What doesn't change? Tell me. What doesn't change? Human nature. Human nature has been the same right through the century, right through millennia, right? Have we changed much? Suit boot pehen liye toh hum change ho gaye thoda? Have we changed? you scratch the surface and the animal comes out, right? And what happens when a choke point is choked actually? Istanbul is the best example. In 1453, the Turks won Istanbul. I mean, earlier it used to be called Constantinople. It was the capital of the Eastern Roman Empire, and Constantinople became Istanbul in 1453. And they choked. The Turks choked the spice route, which used to go by land into Europe. Hamare sab masale Hindustan se used to go by road to Europe. And the Turks choked it, literally charging too much of toll. So what happened? 1453, the Turks choked Istanbul. By 1460, the Portuguese had already landed at the tip of Africa, Cape of Good Hope. In 6-7 years, they landed at the Cape of Good Hope, trying to find a route to India. Within 40 years of the choking of Istanbul, 1492, Christopher Columbus landed up in America, trying to find a route again to India. He thought he had landed in India, but it happened to be the West Indies. That's why they are called the West Indies. And within 50 years, Vasco da Gama landed on Indian shores. So what happens when a choke point is choked? See what happens. In 50 years, they found a route to India by sea. And look at the history of the world. We got colonized, the whole world got colonized by the Europeans, right? See, unko, these guys, the Turks wanted to jam them. The Europe was going through the dark ages. And look what happened. When you finger or tamper with a choke point, what can happen? Look at the implications, right? So this is the Straits of Bosphorus. Here you can see it very clearly here. Why? This is the Straits of Bosphorus. Yeah. This is the Black Sea. Again, the Russians cannot get out of the Black Sea into the Mediterranean unless they go through the Straits of Bosphorus. They are choked in there. And that is why Turkey is a NATO ally. Though it is not a part of the European Union, it is still a NATO ally of the Americans. And they give them huge funding because to keep them on the sides of the Americans. If the Turks join the Russians, you can imagine what can be. There will be a totally different thing. So it's all the politics of the world, all the economics of the world is linked to these points. You know, there is this gentleman, you should just make a note of him. His name is Halford, H-A-L-F-O-R-D, Halford Mackinder. M-A-C-K-E-N-D-E-R, Halford Mackinder. Halford Mackinder was the founder director of the London School of Economics, right? The London School of Economics, the founder, one of the founder directors was Halford Mackinder. He was knighted by the British government. And more important, he is the first person to have started teaching geography as a formal subject at Oxford University. The first time geography was being taught as a formal subject was by Halford Mackinder. And not just that, he is considered to be the father of geostrategy and geopolitics in the world today. Halford Mackinder, do you get the connect between geography and economics? What is economics? Economics is a function of demand and supply, right? Economics is demand and supply. Abhi tomato ke bhaav badh gaye. Kyo badh gaye? Because shortage ho gayi hai. Because of the rain, there is less supply. That's why the price goes up. When there are huge supply, the prices will come down. So economics is a function of demand and supply. Now geography is your destiny. Geography is your destiny. Your character, your culture, everything is being shaped by geography. See, just look at yourself, which region do you come from? You know the word religion comes from the word region? Religion comes from the word region. So it's very contextual. So geography is your destiny. Now for the Russians, they cannot get out of, see, this is the white is the Black Sea, this is the Mediterranean, this is Russia here, after having broken down from the USSR. So now the Russians cannot get out of the Black Sea here, their Black Sea fleet of submarines and ships cannot get out unless they navigate the Bosphorus. And here also the Baltic, see, this is Copenhagen here, this is Copenhagen, and the St. Petersburg, right? So they cannot get out, and if they are choked here at these two places, the Russians are virtually landlocked. Russia is the biggest country in the world. It spans 11 time zones. We are, as a country, India is 1.5 time zones. How much? 1.5 time zones. You can imagine Russia. It is 11 time zones. For convenience, they made it 9 time zones. But the problem of Russia is they are virtually landlocked. Their ports, these ports here at St. Petersburg and Novorossiysk and all, are literally frozen for 9 to 10 months in a year. So with all they have, they cannot trade. The Russians cannot trade. It's like you having 10 million tons of gold. You are a very rich person, right? 10 million tons of gold. But if you cannot sell it, what do you do with it? Sleep on it, dance on it. What do you do with that gold? If you cannot sell it, there is no market value to it. So with all that wealth of Russia, Russia is not able to trade because no ports. The ports are frozen 10 months in a year. What do you do? That is the problem for the Russian bear. This is Istanbul. I mean, see, here you'll get a very good picture here. This white is the Baltic, this is Copenhagen here, and this is the Black Sea. This dark green is Greece, all these thousand islands of Greece. So whatever the European world or the Americans might say about Greece going bankrupt or what, they will never ditch Greece because it helps them keep a check on the Russians here. You know, the shipping of the world, all the shipping industry of the world is owned by three countries, literally. The Greeks, the Denmarks, Danes, and the Norwegians. See, this is Norway, this grey. This tiny here is, this is Denmark, and this is Greece. They control and own the shipping of the world. Pura duniya ka shipping industry, who owns? Malik ye log hai. Aur nokar log kaun hai? The Indians, the Chinese, and the Filipinos, because we have the numbers. Who owns? These three countries own: Norway, Denmark, and Greece. You understand now the locations? See the locations. To malik wo ban ke baithe hain, hum naukar ban ke baithe hain. The Chinese, the Indians, and the Filipinos. We man the shipping industry of the world, they own us. So this is very, very instructive here. Look at the geography here. Sorry. See, there is another possibility now to build a canal here. It's called the Isthmus of Kra. You can build another canal here and just imagine what can happen. It can save a lot of time sailing here via Singapore. So the Chinese are very keen to build this canal. Very keen. But yes, this is Burma and Thailand here. So a lot of issues, political, ecological, all sort of issues here. But there is a possibility to build a canal here. And this is how the trade of oil, the oil flows. You can imagine here. See, this is Hormuz. Right? If Hormuz is choked, what can happen? Just check. Aden, Gibraltar, Singapore, Panama. These are the, like, the Nadi Shastra of the world. And this is a given. This you cannot change. No one can change this. All the world's politics lies in the way the map is drawn. This is geography. You can't change it. And not just that. All the internet cables, all you young generation guys, you will be starved of the internet, because all the internet cables also run like this only. There is no other way the internet cables go. This is how the internet cables are laid under sea. And this is going to remain a constant in our lives. Human nature is going to remain the same. So what do we need to do? We as Indians, what do we need to do? How do we need to think? This is how the British looked at the world. उनका देखने का नजरिया ये था. हम कैसे देखते हैं? हम तो देखते भी नहीं इंडियन ओशन की तरफ. See, we are the only country in the world with an ocean named after us. Have you heard of a Chinese ocean, British ocean, French ocean, Russian ocean, American ocean? नहीं, हमारे नाम से ओशन है, हम देखते भी नहीं उसकी तरफ. That's why you have Ajmal Kasab coming by a fishing boat, taking over our financial capital. हम उसको बिरयानी खिला रहे हैं. हाँ, कितने हॉस्पिटेबल हैं, हमारी खातिरदारी तो देखो. राइट, व्हाई? बिकॉज वी डोंट वांट टू लुक एट द ओशन. सी, दिस इज द इंडियन ओशन रिम. सी, राइट फ्रॉम हियर, सी, दिस इज पोर्ट एलिजाबेथ, दिस इज बॉम्बे. यू सॉ द डिस्टेंस? बॉम्बे टू पोर्ट एलिजाबेथ is cheaper than Bombay to Delhi. I told you the economics. 18,000 containers, 40 containers, 2 containers on a trailer. Kar lo hisab abhi aap. Work out your economics. This is how world trade goes. There are 3 million Indians living here. Kitne? Whole of East, you see, if you divide Africa into vertically, agar do tukde karo aap Africa ke vertically, whole of East Africa is almost English speaking, because it was under the British Empire. So you can speak. All the tour operators in Africa here are all Gujubais, Patels from Gujarat. You can talk in Gujarati. I was surprised. I went to climb Kilimanjaro 15 years ago, and this Maasai guide came to receive me at Nairobi airport. He is telling me, "Hello, kem cho?" I saw this black Maasai fellow talking to me in Gujarati. I was also taken aback. Yes, I said, his name was Onesmo. I said, "Onesmo, you speak Gujarati?" He says, "Yes, my landlady in Nairobi is a Gujarati lady." Then he took me out for lunch. Then after lunch, he's telling me, "Tame ladu khaso, ladu?" I couldn't really digest it, an African Maasai fellow talking to me in Gujarati. But he was living with a Guju landlady. Oh, mega bola, "Ladu khaso, ladu." But see, whole of East Africa is English speaking. There are, all this is English speaking here. There is a Mallu friend of mine. He says in the UAE, in the Gulf, he says the first language of the Gulf, Praful, is, you know what? It's not Arabic, it is not English, it is Malayalam. Kya bolta hai wo? The first language of the Gulf is Malayalam, which is fact. He says we Malayalis, we don't work in Kerala. We don't allow anyone else to work. But you take a Malayali out of Kerala, you see how he works. If you want any work done in Dubai or anywhere in the Middle East, hire a Malayali. Because the Malayali network works. He says they don't give us citizenship. Otherwise, we would have a Mallu Prime Minister in the UAE. Kya bolta hai wo? There are so many Malayalis. Half of Kerala is in the Gulf. Half of Kerala is in the Gulf, right? Now, yeah, you go into Pakistan. What is the language of Pakistan? Boliye, Urdu, right? If you listen to Pakistan, it is Punjabi. Yes, you are right. See, half of Punjab came to India, half Punjab went to Pakistan. And the Pakistani Punjab, they speak Punjabi. Urdu, if you listen to Pakistani TV, you can understand everything, almost, right? You go to Bengal here, his Bangladesh is what? Which language? Bengali, right? You go to Malaysia, Tamil is official language. You know that? Tamil is official language of Malaysia. Of Singapore, Sri Lanka also Tamil is official language. Just imagine the number of Indians. We are the second largest population in Australia. Indians are the second largest population in Australia. Just imagine the amount of Indians sitting across the Indian Ocean rim. हम कितने लोग बैठे हैं यहाँ पे? Just imagine, right around here, we are there, already there. If you go to, I went to Mauritius, you know what is the official language of Mauritius? Bhojpuri, yes. Lalu Prasad Yadav went to Mauritius and he was a big hit there. Why? And with the history of Bali Jatra, the first port in the world was Lothal, Mohenjo-daro Harappa civilization. 7,000 years ago, this is our glorious history and this is what we have become. Why? Because we have this thing called Kala Pani. Kala Pani was a concept which forbid Indians, it was a taboo for Indians to go across the seas. I asked my Nanaji once, ki chaliye mere saath Singapore. He said, main nahi aata. Main kyo karam bandhu? Why should I commit sins by going to Singapore? He didn't want to come with me. See, I am working now on, I started my own NGO. It's called Suvarna Samudra, the Golden Ocean, because I want to erase this Kala Pani out of the human Indian mind. And I want to start, I am starting with Pune district to, now there are a lot of water bodies in Pune, big lakes and water, rivers and all. So I am going to help their children from those areas to join the Navy or the Indian Merchant Navy through this Suvarna Samudra thing. That is my personal initiative. But see, this is, we need to change the culture of continental India to maritime India. Otherwise, we will never ever become a superpower. This is my message. I hope I have been able to convince you on this. Thank you very much. I think have I run out of time or have time? Perfect, done. Any questions you want me to take? Any questions? Any questions, anything? Politics, history, geography, war. Thank you very much. Thank you. And I'd like to invite you.
Thank you, sir, for your knowledgeable words and giving us insight about the world trade through sea. Thank you for investing time with the upcoming working generation. We break here for a 10-minute tea break. Please move like a tidal wave and be back to grasp more out of the day.
Thank you. And
thank you, sir. Your session absolutely enthralled us. It was a fascinating experience listening to your opinions about accounting and finance, as these are the contest for people's attention. There is food for brain, but that cannot compensate for lunch. The most admired time of the day. Yes, it is the lunch time. So, let all of us head towards our preferred destination, canteen, and satisfy our appetite. See you all in an hour. We have some more interesting people to meet post-lunch.